I am so excited to be here. UK has showed me so much love already. What I like to do is I get their signatures when I give them mine. So I got a little piece of them to take away with me, man, to keep inspired, because it's so much love and inspiration right here at the London Film and Comic Con. It's beautiful, man. I'm glad to be here. Oh, man, it was fun to be recognized as the number one actor on Netflix. I'm pretty much in more shows or movies than anybody. So, yeah, I mean, you know, to be singled out as that is a pretty good feeling. You know, it's a testament of hard work tasting great. And it's also a step closer to my ultimate goal of getting a series regular role. I have yet to be a series regular on any of these, but yet I still get recognized as, you know, this big part of Netflix universe. So it's fun.
The Marvel shows on Netflix each had a very different character, a very different tone. What was it like to be one of the few characters that really was a bridging point for those series and kind of popped up in all of them at some point?
Man, you know, it was a beautiful feeling being that Turk Barrett, he's pretty much the connecting glue to the whole universe. And to have that kind of responsibility and play it out and do it in such a way that people take it as fun and comedy and, you know, they really get excited when my character pops up. I mean, man, who wouldn't want to get that kind of reception as a storyteller and an actor? So I love being that guy, yeah.
The lineup of talent in our Defenders cast is pretty sensational. Can you talk about, I mean, was there a particular highlight for you, one person in particular or one show that you had the most fun on for one reason or another?
Oh, man, I would say Luke Cage, probably. My man Mike Coulter was phenomenal to work with. Ron Cephas Jones, Frankie Faison, you know, all them brothers was just phenomenal. Mahershala Ali, you know, it was just a great synergy on cast. Simone Missick, the names could keep going on and on and on. But yeah, I gotta say that Luke Cage experience was something special. Even though I only had like a couple episodes, but I felt that my presence was very, very special, yeah.
One of the most exciting things, particularly looking to the future for Marvel, is that question of representation. And of course, Mahershala has just been confirmed as our new Blade, and we've got a series. Can you talk about how important that element of the MCU is for you, particularly having heroes like Luke Cage and Blade front and center going forward?
Oh, man, it's very important, especially when we live in a society where our presence is devalued oftentimes in media, either through justice or police brutality or even just in representation. We're hardly ever seen. So for us to have a place that can show a different side, show various color hues of our community, and speak to us in a way that we can receive it well, I think that's very, very important, and I hope that it opened the door for many more to come.
Stranger Things remains a global phenomenon. Why do you think that show has become such an important cultural reference point for so many people? Why is it the international sensation that it remains?
Well, I think it's very nostalgic to an 80s time period. I think the Duffer Brothers and Sean Levy put a lot into the production and the design and the storytelling and the feel. And if you wasn't in the 80s, if you were to take it in now, it makes you wish you were in the 80s. You know what I mean? As a child, it could resonate from the 8, 9-year-old to the 50, 60-year-old. And to have that kind of material, have that kind of impact on such a wide market, I think it's a testament of how pinpointed they were in telling that time period, because it's very attractive. For Stranger Things, I would say my favorite reference was probably that little green Pinto, the car, the Pinto car. I even have pictures of it on my phone, because when we were shooting the scenes and the car was in the house, out in front of the house, we were in the house, I just was so impressed by how immaculate and well put together this little green Pinto was, man. So yeah, that really stands out in my mind.
There's an attractive chemistry between you and David on that show. Can you talk a little bit about what makes him so great and how you felt along with fans about the somewhat climactic events of season 3?
Well, I'm not going to spoil anything for season 3. David Harbour is a phenomenal artist. He's very intelligent. He's very passionate. And I think I have some of those attributes also. So when we met and clicked and worked together, it came off in our chemistry and our relationship. Yeah, he's a phenomenal lead. I really feel that he should probably even get more recognition and more awards for his story presence in Stranger Things, but I'm pretty sure the kind of artist that he is, eventually they'll come. The memory from set that makes me crack the biggest smile is probably in season one, and it really probably isn't a good memory for everybody, but for me it was a memory that made me crack a smile because it showed me the phenomenal talent of these young kids, you know, and that was the scene when Will was being found in the water, and it was freezing cold out there. It was freezing. I mean, freezing. And the commitment that those kids put into finding Will, and the little girl who was the stunt double for Will, getting in that water as cold as it was, man, and so committed. Like, man, I often think about how her condition is after her committing herself to that scene, and then seeing how the children played off of it so perfectly and so emotionally and so connected. It just, man, it made me crack a smile because it made me believe in the future, you know what I mean? And seeing these little artists, these kids, have this capacity to tell this story in such a brilliant way. So, yeah, that made me crack a smile. I know it's strange, but that made me crack a smile.
And what does the future hold for you at the moment? Where are we going to see you next?
Man, actually, to be completely honest, I don't know. I haven't worked in 9 months. You know, I'm looking for work all the time. You know, people know I'm out here. You know, I have just did a lead of a film called Bull at Cannes. I played the lead cowboy in the movie. We'll see what happens with that. I have a film called Just Mercy that's coming out at TIFF, Toronto International Film Festival, in September. We'll see what happens after that. But that's my old work. I'm looking for new work. So if you have a job, call Rob Morgan. He would love to work.